We are back with the second half of chapter 9 of Watson's Go to Birmingham. The only one who didn't do anything to get ready to go to Alabama was Byron. He acted like nothing was going to happen, even though Mama got a bunch of our clothes together and put them in suitcases. The smelly green pine tree was hung from the rearview mirror, and all the lists and figuring were done, but Byron acted like he didn't even notice. Even after a few more yelling phone calls were made to Alabama, Daddy Cool just kept being cool. Byron didn't even get nervous when Mama packed a whole bunch of food in the giant green cooler we borrowed from the Johnsons. After all of this stuff, it was finally the night before we were supposed to leave. We just got in bed. Byron was up in his bunk and I was down in mine. I was so excited I was talking a mile a minute. But I was talking to myself. Byron wouldn't answer or anything. There was a knock at our bedroom door. Come in. It was Mom and Dad. Mama said, lights out, Kenneth. Byron, you come with us. What for? We thought since this was the last night you were going to be spending in Flint for a while, you might like to sleep in our room tonight. You thought what? Byron had a way of saying stuff in a few words that made it seem like he was saying a whole bunch more. Come on by. You're bunking with us tonight, Dad said. Aw, man. Byron jumped out of the top bunk and gave me his death stare. I just shrugged. I guess the grapevine had gotten back to Mom and Dad that Bi was going to make a prison break tonight before he got transferred to Alabama. He thought I was the snitch, but it was Joey. She knew if Mama and Dad got up in the morning and Byron had flown the coop, that he'd really be a dead man when they finally recaptured him. So I guess she saved his life by snitching. But Bi sure didn't appreciate it. I sneaked out of bed after Mama and Dad arrested Byron. I was too excited to sleep and too excited to read. I looked out the window at the brown bomber, and I couldn't believe it was going to take us all the way to Alabama. The trip didn't become real to us until 9 in the morning when we were in the car waving goodbye to Rufus and heading towards I-75, a road that runs all the way from Flint to Florida. One road. We weren't even on the expressway before Mama started reading out of her notebook, telling us everything she had planned for the next 3 days. Day one today. We leave Flint and we drive for 300 miles in about five and a half hours. That will take us to Cincinnati. 300 miles in one day? It just didn't seem like that could be done. Me and Joey shook our heads. Byron looked out the window. In Cincinnati, we'll get a room in a motel. We brought plenty of blankets so you kids will be able to sleep on the floor. Me and Joey cheered. We'd never been in a motel before. Byron just kept looking out the window. Day two tomorrow. Now your daddy and this car both aren't as young as they used to be. So we don't want to push either one of them too hard. Dad looked shocked. So we rise and shine real early in the morning and drive for 250 miles in about 5 or 6 hours. That should put us right outside of Knoxville, Tennessee. Mr. Johnson says that there are some clean, safe rest stops there so we can spend the night in the car. If that's true, we'll stay there. If not, we'll have to see if we can find a motel room in Knoxville. Day three, Monday. This is going to be a tough day for your daddy because he's going to have to drive for more than 6 hours. After we leave Knoxville, we've got about 300 miles to go. If we leave early enough, we'll be pulling into home at about 3 p.m. Mama turned her page in the notebook. We're going to be able to stop once a day on the way down for hamburgers, and once a day on the way back. Me and Joey cheered again at this news. Byron acted like he didn't hear. Now, if we sleep in the car outside Knoxville, we can stop one more bonus time coming and going. Otherwise, the cooler in the trunk is full of chicken, soda pop, potato salad sandwiches, and fruit for the whole trip down. I'm sure Grandma Sands will have everything set for the way back. I thought about it for a minute, and then I asked, Mama, how come we don't just drive until Dad gets tired and then stop? Dad did an imitation of a hillbilly accent. Cause boy, this here is the deep south. You all is gonna be driving through. Y'all color folks can't be just pulling up to any old way. and be expecting getting no room and no food. Yeah, boy. I said, you hear what I'm saying, boy? Me and Joey laughed again, and even Byron kind of smiled. This only encouraged Dad to say some more Southern-style stuff. Y'all didn't know that, boy. What's the matter with you? You think this is here is America? Mama had everything planned about the trip, everything. Where we'd eat, when we'd eat. Who got bologna sandwiches day one? Who got tuna fish on day two? Who got peanut butter and jelly on day three? She figured out how long we could hold ourselves between going to the bathroom, how much money we'd spend on hamburgers, how much was for any emergencies, everything. She figured out who'd get the window on each day and who was responsible for keeping the paper and junk from piling up in the car. When she finished reading all that stuff to us, I asked her if I could look at the notebook. She handed it to me, and I saw written on the cover in big black letters, "The Watsons go to Birmingham, 1963. She'd even drawn a flower with a big, fat, stupid bird trying to land on it. Ma'am, Mama sure is a bad artist. Why is this bird trying to land on a flower, Mama? Dad cracked up. Ooh, Kenneth, I asked her the same thing, and she was highly offended. Mama said, that's a bee, not a bird. I guess if you squinched your eyes up, it might look a lot like a bee, but not too much. Mom had also gone to the library to look up stuff about every state we travel through. We heard a bunch of boring junk about the expressway, how many years it took to finish it, how many miles long it was, how much it cost to build it, how it ran all the way from the Upper Peninsula in Michigan to Florida. All kinds of thrilling news. The only thing that was a little bit interesting was how many people got killed and hurt making the road. You never would think putting an expressway down is so dangerous. She bought books and puzzles and games too. She really did try to make the trip interesting. The most interesting part for me though was going to be Byron. 2 days before we left, Buphead came to visit Byron. The three of us were in my and By's bedroom. They'd tried to bully me out of the room, but I stayed. They were sitting in the upper bunk and I was in the lower one. Man, Buphead complained, I couldn't live with your old man. We'd be coming to blows daily, Jack. What can I say? Byron answered. Not much. I can't believe they're going to make you spend the whole blanket summer in hot old Alabama. Shoot, I'd find somewhere else to stay. You're going to be as black as the ace of spades when you get back. They got some sure enough sun down there. Yeah, but dig. I got a way to pay them jive old squares back. Yeah? What you going to do? I ain't even sure I'm gonna go, but if I do, I know how they is. They're gonna try some of that Ozzie and Harriet TV show mess on the way down. You know, playing games and counting crows and guessing how many red cars we're gonna see in the next 2 miles and all that kind of 369, but I'm ready for them. Yeah? I got something that'll mess that junk up for all of them. What's that, Daddy-O? Byron remembered I was in the lower bunk and stuck his head over the edge and then pointed at me. You say one word about this to anyone, I'm gonna jack your little lightweight behind up. You hear? I said, oh man. By disappeared back into the top bunk. Yeah, Buphead. If I do go, I'm gonna go that whole blind trip, and no matter what they do to me, I ain't gonna say one single word. Whoa, how long the trip gonna take? 3 days? Cool. That'll show them. They slapped palms and By said, yeah, you know, it will. But as soon as we got to Detroit, Byron said, how are we going to work the record player? Dad looked in the rearview mirror and said to By, what do you mean? We going to take turns? Well, Byron, I don't think we'll be playing it quite a bit yet. We can carry CKLW all the way down to Ohio, and they play some pretty good music. But when we do play it, are we going to take turns? Sure. Cool. Am I first? Sure. We'll go by seniority. Dad was in the United Auto Workers, so seniority was real important in our house. Cool. I couldn't help myself. I leaned over Joey and said kind of quiet to By, I guess you really showed him, didn't you? Boy, they were really begging you to talk, weren't they, Daddy-O? Byron made sure Joey wasn't watching and then flipped me a dirty finger sign and made his eyes go crossed. On the left, kids, is Tiger Stadium. Mama was pointing out all the important things as we passed on the way. As the payback was for giving me the dirty finger, I said out loud to By, how many cows he counted, By? How many red cars so far? He gave me his famous death stare and then leaned over Joey and whispered, "No cars, no cows, but I counted your mama 6 times already." I couldn't believe it. What kind of person would talk about their own mama? I said, "That's your mother too, stupid." I knew he didn't care, though, but I had to get him back, so I called him the only thing that bothered him. I said, "You might have counted my mama 6 times, but have you counted your mouth lately, lipless wonder?" I got him. He showed his teeth and said, "You little," and he tried to grab me. Dad's eyes were in the rearview mirror. "All right, you two," I said, "no nonsense, and I don't mean maybe." Byron used silent mouth language to say, "I'm gonna jack you up in Alabama, you punk." So as we drove down I-75 headed for Birmingham, I felt pretty good. Even though every time I looked at his eyes were crossed, I didn't care, because this is the one time I bugged him more than he bugged me.